It is Ham Radio Now, episode 133, Ham Radio Now at the Movies. And playing the part of Gene Siskel, movie critic for, what was it, the Chicago Tribune, I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, and playing the part of Roger Ebert, movie critic for the Chicago Sun-Times, is, an empty chair. Well, here's the story. It was my buddy Jeff, AC4ZO, and we recorded nearly an hour's worth of stuff. And then this computer thing here that I'm recording on had a horrible failure, and the file got corrupted. And I ran it through some repair software and tried to get it back together, and that never really could. Jeff volunteered to come back, but it's getting kind of late in the day, and so I didn't even ask him to come back and, you know, let him have an uninterrupted evening. I will try to remember about what he said. But the second half of the program, after that failure, that video is fine, and Jeff will magically appear. So in this program, we're going to take a look at two fairly recent videos that have been released on the Ham Radio Public. The first one is this one, the ARRL at 100. It's been out for a little while now. It's the league's sort of a celebration of the past 100 years of amateur radio and the ARRL. And the second program that we're going to take a look at is this one. And this one is brand new. Just came out yesterday, I think, the TX Factor. It's a British program. And it is produced by three hams from the UK, and looks like it's going to be a new series. So, just what we need, more competition here on ham radio video. But well, let's see what we've got to say about both of those. I am going to get critical about my peers here in the ham radio video realm, and before I get critical on them, I think I need to prove that I can take it. And, well, the 60-meter program has just wrapped up. It's been out there for a while. And I knew that that was going to gather some reaction, and it has. Some of it good, some of it, for me, everything is good, but some of it negative. And a lot of it just kind of, yeah. By the way, I did file my comments. They have gone in. I modified them a little bit from what I talked about in the program. But pretty much what I said about channelized 60 meters, and I was right, not a particularly popular position. But I'm not going to talk about the 60-meter, the content of the 60-meter thing. I'm going to talk about what people said about my program style and performance, because whatever they say about the concept of 60 meters channelized or not, that's irrelevant to a review of the program. All right, here's the first guy talking about me. This is K2WH. I'm going to read what he says for those of you that are just listening in audio. This was a comment made on QRZ.com on the announcement of the program. And he says, "I just can't stand it. I tried. Believe me, I tried, but your treatment of issues and subjects is all about watching your face." That would be like this. "With the cans on." Yes, I'm wearing the headphones so that I can hear the stuff that's being played here when I play some audio coming up. But I like the headphones. I think it's a ham radio kind of thing. "Watching your face with the cans on and your continual switching back and forth of camera shots is nauseating." I might be putting a little bit too much emphasis in. I don't know if he meant it that harshly. "Watching your face with the cans on and you're continually switching back and forth of camera shots is nauseating." Maybe he meant it more like that. No, he didn't. "You are a talking head without substance and without a plan or subject. Ham Nation is way beyond your feeble attempts at mimicry. I think you need to apply at a radio station as a DJ. Lose the cans." This is what it would look like without the headphones. I like them. They cover up the bald spot. to some extent. Okay, so I got pasted on that one. How about this one? JD says, talk radio on video. I can never get past the first 6 minutes with your videos. The subjects you cover are neither interesting nor good use of video. Try an audio format only, and maybe it might make sense. Good luck, Gary. So I don't quite get it. I'm not sure why something would work better as just audio than audio and video. The subject matter shouldn't make any difference. But I do release the programs as audio only. So if you look on the Ham Radio Now website, you can download an MP3 of any of the programs as just audio. That makes you happier. Jeff and I had a long discussion about the value of talking head video programs. Jeff does not like talking head video programs. He likes video programs that go out there into the field and shoot stuff. And I like them too, and I like to make them. It's just that, and we both agree, they take lots longer to do, and I wouldn't be able to make very many of them. I could make a few a year, and I still will make a few, but I can do lots of these talking head programs and get a lot of content out there. And by the way, either one takes time and money to do. The field-produced stuff takes lots more time and lots more money. So a good time to remind you that Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you, and your conduit for bringing yourself Ham Radio Now is this guy back here, my buddy Arvin, the mascot. So stop by hamradionow.tv. If you like the programs, make a contribution. I'm still looking for $10 for a whole year, $10 a viewer for a year. If we get thousands of hams watching the programs and everybody kicks in $10, then I'll make a decent living. I can do this nearly full time and we can keep things going. And if not, then it'll limp along as best it can. I still like doing them. And I got all this equipment. It's all paid for. So we'll use it. Just have to do other stuff too. So where do we stand here? ARRL at 100, a century of amateur radio. Let's watch the program get started here.
Hi, I'm Becky Schoenfeld, W1BXY. I'm standing in front of W1AW, the flagship operating station at the American Radio Relay League in Newington, Connecticut. Over the next half hour, we're going to take you on a journey through time, exploring the...
That's a real strong opening. Becky did a really good job on that. Jeff and I bantered back and forth about the concept of how professional someone needs to be. In fact, he thought that Becky was an on-camera pro. Becky's not. She's the managing editor of QST. This is not her primary job. She may have done things like this before in her career. I don't know. But that's not what really she really does for a living. She puts together QST. But she did a real strong opening here. I don't know if it was memorized. She's standing so far from the camera. I don't think it could have been telepromptered or written down. So I think she probably memorized that part. And that may be why it came off like that's just what she was talking about. I mean, it was clearly scripted, but it sounded more like it was somewhat extemporaneous, like she was just talking, like I'm doing right now. There's no clearly no script here for this. So a very strong opening, but in my estimation, the program kind of went off the rails and went sort of downhill from there. Now, I'm not going to play the whole thing. You probably already seen it. And if you haven't, you really should. It's not a horrible program to watch. It's a good program, but it's just not as well produced as I would have liked it to have been. So I guess I'm tipping my hand on in terms of the review. Strong opening, but it kind of went downhill. So what are the things that I had a problem with? And by the way, Jeff didn't have a problem with most of this. His overall review of the program was mixed. Liked some things, had trouble with some things, but he seemed to have problems with different areas than I did. So let's see what there is about it that gave me some difficulty.
The ARRL is the primary source of information about what is going on in the ham radio world. It provides a number of books and web pages covering a spectrum of topics, and also provides news, support, and information for individuals and clubs, along with special operating events and all sorts of continuing education classes and other benefits to members.
So here you can tell it's less natural. She's you know, doing more reading to us. She does a pretty good job of reading to us. I don't know if they auditioned everybody and picked the best person that could go on camera and do this sort of thing. Because I've recorded a lot of non-professional people, people who have to go on camera for one reason or another, or on mic if it's just audio. And that's not what they do for a living. And of that group of people, the folks that are not professionally on camera or on mic, Becky's near the top of the group of people that aren't the pros at it, that are just ordinary people trying to do a difficult job, more difficult than you might think, getting on camera. She's way up near the top.
Join me as we go on this.
But now here is what Jeff and I really both liked. It's this timeline that took you back from, here's the music is taking us back in time, to the beginning of the league and then seeing a lot of the history. We both like really seeing that that history.
Experiments to communicate by radio started toward the end of the 1800s. The universe has been bouncing around electromagnetic waves since time
And they did
began.
This analogy of Much the like spectrum with a piano. I kind of like that. I think it's kind of effective.
These electromagnetic waves span many frequencies. Microwaves.
Now, this is designed, I think, for hams to be watching. And if you're a ham, this may be a little bit too simplistic for you. But there's still some good teaching value to it. Well, I guess that's where radio is.
These waves have some miraculous abilities.
Okay, so let's look at where I had my biggest problem. It's when some of the other folks at ARRL come on camera to present their pieces. Again, without showing you the whole program, it's a little bit hard to make the connections or disconnections that I'm seeing in the program. But they seem to come out of nowhere, tagging on to what Becky is saying, apparently appearing for no other reason other than that they wanted to put a lot of people on camera from the league.
Adopting what works best in a free exchange of ideas and new technology. It's been this philosophy which has kept us strong for over a century.
It's clear that the Herald is just reading his lines, you know, looking at probably a script or teleprompter or something. The technique of looking off camera, you know, talking to somebody off camera when you're not really in the middle of an interview, you're just talking to the audience, but looking over there, that people have been doing that for a while. It bothers me, but for some reason it's become a popular thing to do. So the production company probably talked him into doing that that style. Or maybe Alan Pitts, W1AGP, who wrote it and pretty much put this, producing it. I don't know if he's got a producer credit or just, I know he's got a writer credit. It may have been his idea. And, you know, it actually bothers me a lot to be criticizing the program because Alan's a friend of mine. We worked together on a bunch of projects. When I've been up at headquarters, he's helped me out on a lot of things. So sorry, Alan. But it is a review and you got to call it like it is. So when you're looking at the folks who are talking off camera
upon pretty much
and they're just kind of reading.
Through the ARRL, hams have developed a tradition of on-the-air courtesy. Bad behavior is shunned and anonymity is not tolerated.
Yeah, to me, it feels awkward.
So the fight was on. This was the first of many great challenges faced by the ARRL.
So Sean is the league's new media and public relations guy. He's taken over for Alan. And you can tell he's much more comfortable doing this. He sounds more like he's talking to the audience. Still, you know, a little bit weird that he's talking off camera. But at least he's got a good presentation style. The overall impression that I got, though, once the program was finished, was that, well, the material was good and it, you know, there's a lot of value and stuff in it that you can learn about, that presents what the league has been all about, what ham radio has been all about. I just didn't get much of a sense of fun. I mean, ham radio is supposed to be fun. We do it because we really love it. And everyone was awkward enough and it was was presented in sort of an educational form, I just didn't get the sense that what we do and what this program was and what the people in it were feeling was fun. That made the program more difficult for me to watch. So Jeff and I talked about this for a long time. I really wish that material was available to show you, but it's not. So in any case, this is going to be a much shorter program because the next thing we go on to is the program called the TX Factor. And it got announced a couple of weeks ago on QRZ.com and probably a few other spots. They call themselves the United Kingdom's first TV show dedicated to amateur radio, and it just came out. They had put a tease online a couple weeks ago, and I looked at that and I thought, this is looking pretty good. Clearly a lot of field production in it. I really wonder, though, because the tease didn't show the presenters very much. Didn't really see what kind of style they were going to have. They just voiceover announcer, and they showed some of the topics that they would be covering in the first program. So what were they going to be like? Now, looking at their website, it looks like it's going to be a serious program. And as we look at the guys themselves, Bob McCready, Mike Marsh, and Nick Bennett, they've got broadcasting background, not just as engineers. They've all been on the air in one form or another. Now, they may have also been doing engineering, but they have been on the air. So held out hope that they could have a pretty polished production. We'll take a look at a bit of the show.
TX Factor is brought to you in association with Martin Lynch & Sons, the world's favorite ham store, and Yaesu Music.
Oh, yeah, they have advertisers.
Yeah. Well, they have one.
They have two.
Oh, they have two?
So they do a fancy open. Have you noticed I don't do a fancy open?
Yeah, and I like that.
Yeah, just...
Hello, and welcome to the first episode of the UK's very first TV program dedicated entirely to amateur radio. This is the TX Factor, and I'm Bob McCready, G0FGX. In this episode, I'm reporting from Poldhu here in Cornwall. I'm at the Marconi Centre, where in 1901, with the aid of a huge antenna and a 20,000-volt spark, a certain Signor Marconi bridged the wild Atlantic Ocean by radio for the first time.
And I'm Nick Bennett, 2E0FGQ. A little bit further north than Bob, but with some equally stunning views to enjoy, if a little windy today. I'm on Stiper Stones, a hill dominating the skyline to the southwest of Shrewsbury, in the heart of England and close to the Welsh borders.
That's two.
I ventured this high to prove that with antennas, size isn't everything. What really makes a difference is how high you can get it.
We've said that on our programs in the past, I believe.
The reward scheme can keep you fit and get you some big signals from some stunning locations.
And I'm Mike Marsh, G1IAR, a little bit further up the coast than Bob, in the beautiful seaside town of Sidmouth, East Devon. This is the Norman Lockyer Radio Group and home of special event call sign GB2NLO. Thanks, guys. Well, up here on the windy clifftops at Poldhu in Cornwall is...
So, yeah, they have broadcast personalities.
Yeah.
Not real stiff and formal.
Mm-hmm.
But clearly reading something or performing something that had been pre-written, a script, ready to go.
Right.
But they do it well.
Yeah.
Unlike, I don't know if you're getting the difference between the folks that were reading their stuff for ARRL and these guys reading their stuff.
Yeah, big difference.
Okay. Do you care?
No. Well, this was definitely more fun to watch. But the ARRL video, you know, it's fine. Yes, these guys look like they're addressing the camera, not addressing who knows what.
Well, yeah, they deliberately were talking to the camera, talking to you, the audience.
Yeah, and I thought that's easier to listen to, less distracting.
Yep, I think you've pointed your microphone away from you a little bit.
Okay, I'm going to make noise when I move
that's
it here.
Okay. Clunk, clunk, clunk. I do apologize. Okay. I need to get you a... need to get a stand for
it. Okay. Am I coming through a little better now?
Much better.
Okay.
So you were saying. about their performance.
Yeah, that I thought it was easier to watch, just more enjoyable. But you know,
but just not even necessarily the content, just the style.
Right.
We're just talking personality and presentation style.
Right. Right.
I like
the fact that they introduced their three segments that's going to be on the show, you know, and themselves.
We sort of did. Sort of coming and going, halting and misdirecting ourselves. And then eventually we got around to talking about what we were going to talk about.
I'm talking about the show.
Yeah.
The fillers there.
I'm talking about the beginning of this show compared to the beginning of that show.
Oh, yeah. Yes, I like their way better.
Yeah, they are not helter skelter, but then they are not being conversational either.
Right.
Although when they get into some of the interviews inside the program, they're more conversational. We'll take a look at something. He's doing an interview here.
Scientific community very quickly came round to the idea that it had been successful. Marconi had no idea how he'd managed to succeed in the...
So Bob is on camera. You know, he is being part of the interview. He's not a hidden producer type person answering the questions. He's,
right.
He's there.
Right.
Range increased.
The guy he's talking to at this point
really
is...
about how propagation works over long distances, did they? In fact, the reason he chose...
None of this is scripted. This is a conversation.
Sea path. It was the salt water that would make it go around the curve.
Yeah. Yes, he thought it was the conducting medium of the salt water. In fact, in 1899, he took the opportunity of going over to the Great Lakes.
Yep. So that's more fun to watch, just them having a conversation. But all of it, they're doing it. They are what I'm calling head and shoulders and torso and you know, down to about the knee level above just about everything else that's being done in ham radio.
Yeah.
Really, really good job.
Yeah.
And I learned a lot in the conversation with this guy. They're talking, it's not purely ham radio that they're talking about, it's sort of pre-ham radio, but they've got the station that Marconi was doing the transmitting from, or Marconi's people were doing the transmitting from. He was over in Newfoundland at the receiving side, sending that infamous letter S, trying to get across the
ocean. It tells all about it in the program.
Yeah, so you definitely want to watch this show. And it was fun. So a lot of good production value, more interesting camera shots and angles. And I was batting some things back and forth with Bill Pasternak about this. He was thinking that they had a big production budget, which I don't know whether they did or not. And I've passed email back and forth with Bob. He's going to come on the show, and we'll talk about how they did it. But I don't know if it was one camera or multiple cameras. So this has all the hallmarks of single camera. Well, I don't know.
Well, it looked like at least two.
This
and maybe three, because there was one shot that showed both of them.
There was no knowledge, of course, of the
eye. Yeah, this. Or anything like that at the time. Could have two cameras set up for this one.
The effect of sunspots, for instance, was unknown. In fact, he was very, very lucky. He chose almost the shortest day.
You can do that kind of thing with one camera. You can sort of fool it and, you know, stop and move it and ask your question, but that really interrupts the flow of the conversation.
Right, right, and this doesn't sound like that was done. This was smooth and connected and really nice.
The other thing was that it was a sunspot minimum, so the
this is an interesting
very,
concept.
Very weak at that time.
Yeah, let the viewers watch it for themselves, that part. This was a nugget.
Oh, yeah, yeah. It's something that I didn't have a firm grasp on myself.
Yeah.
Because I thought I had been living with the concept that this never happened. I mean, they tried it, but they were unsuccessful. And the guy that's talking there in the show, his premise is that it was successful, and he's got some very good reasons why it was. So go watch the show, and he'll learn something. And I don't think he's going to put an end to the controversy, but the controversy being was
contact successful? Yeah.
Yeah. It never was a contact. It was a one way. It was one letter one way.
Right.
So it was just the letter S.
But. Was the communication successful? But I've been involved in an operation on a Islands on the Air expedition myself that you could really call into question the success of what happened.
Yeah, because the operators, another long story, but the operators were so into the idea that they could be successful that they could have created those success in their own mind, perhaps. Yeah. Not necessarily, but.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, do you have a, and we'll talk about that story someday.
Okay. I don't have very much to say about it because it's somebody else's thunder, you know, yeah. that I don't want to steal, but I wasn't satisfied that they had done what they claimed success for yeah. doing.
We can talk ourselves into a lot of, yeah. I can talk yeah. myself into the idea that this is a good show.
yeah.
and that people like watching it. And then I can look at the YouTube audience retention numbers and say, yeah, 25%.
this well, good let's, audience. Let's both try to fight our ADD and at least get through the review if we could.
Okay. So what we've got in this program is a good video.
Yeah.
Interesting shots.
Mm-hmm.
Probably a little bit too more, a little bit too much people talking on camera for a program that is, in theory, all field production. But because there were some places where people were talking about things that I thought that they could be showing because they were there. Those things were happening. They could have shown a little bit more than they did. But that's pick and nits. It was generally really, really good.
Yep.
And the only thing that I could made a note on for myself was that we didn't get to know these guys at all. They are professional broadcast presenters,
mm-hmm.
but there's none of them comes through. Well, in terms of personality.
You know, in future show, you get to know them as you watch their shows. I'm much more interested in the content they were showing. They had three segments on there, all three very interesting. One about technology, one very specific on ham radio, and specifically new hams, aimed at new hams. So old hams will grumble, you know, oh, it's just another training video for new hams. But you know, even as
that was the soda segment, but... Summit's on the air. The repeater segment.
No, the repeater yeah. segment, right. Yeah. But I like that anyway. It's still fun to watch video about stuff. In fact, sometimes more fun to watch video about stuff you already know about. It's good to see new stuff and stuff you don't know, but it's fun to watch that which is familiar too.
Yeah, well, we can all learn something. I probably even learned something in the repeater segment. Repeaters are my bailiwick.
Yeah.
And, but I'm not an engineer. I never claimed to be.
Mm-hmm.
But that's what I probably know the most about in ham radio. Yeah. And you know why? Because I started in CB and repeaters are CB. Well, that's what I was told.
Oh, I get it now. Yeah, that took a minute for that to click.
I was president of a club called the Chicago FM Club, CFMC.
Yeah, right.
And my best friend called it CBFMC. My best friend. So, you know, because he was not, I was going to say he's not an FMer. He built a repeater. He was a very good engineer. He built a repeater, put it on the air and stuff like that.
Yeah, but to an engineer, you know, once you have it working, the fun's over with. You know, it's done. Start another project.
Exactly. And there that is a really important element of ham radio yeah. is the people that like to build things and make them work and then hand them off to us who play with them.
To talk.
yeah. In the under the mantle of the appliance operator.
Yeah.
I gotta write an article. I got an article for QST that will be called Confessions of an Appliance Operator. It's all in my mind. I just got to get it in words on paper.
Cute. Okay.
see if they'll buy that one.
I'll probably read that.
So, I'm not saying that they should have been more personality. I mean, this is all personality, yeah. you and me. But if we weren't being the people that we are, people wouldn't care about what we're talking about.
Well, it's a good thing we don't have to rely on just the content.
Right. Well... We're I know what I want to say. We're keeping people company.
Okay.
You know, I don't, you know, work by myself. I've got radio going all day, but I don't have music going all day. I've got talk going all day, whether I'm paying a lot of attention to the talk or not, because these people are keeping me company.
Right.
You know, I don't work at a company where I've got people around all day. You got people around all day, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. Well, do you interact with them or do you close the door and hide?
No, I almost never close my office door. Lots of people, it would, every 20 minutes, somebody comes in with something about, it averages about every 20 minutes. It's usually a question.
Yep. And even when I'm working at a client, for a while we're working together and then I'm on my own.
Right.
And, you know, I don't do much water cooler stuff, you know, just hanging around talking to people.
Yeah, I don't either.
You know, what this basically means is I don't like people very much.
Yeah.
Yeah, I am much more, much more, the word I want to say, I don't want to use a 75-cent word, but I will, loquacious. Any idea?
Loquacious, oh yeah. Yeah, like I know what that means. Yeah.
I talk here much more easily than I do in, you know, a party.
In real life.
In real life, yeah. At a party or whatever, I'm a party vegetable. I don't like just small talk conversation with people unless there's a reason for it.
Mm-hmm.
Like this, we're making a show. You and I can talk.
Yeah.
Endlessly, whether there's microphones and cameras pointed at us or not.
Yeah.
You know, we can do that a lot. But very few people do I feel comfortable doing that.
Hmm.
Yeah. So we're driving to Dayton.
Yeah, in between naps. Because yeah, we both take a lot of naps on that trip.
That would be me taking the naps and you doing all the driving. And in between naps, I'm either on the radio or we're talking.
The driving doesn't prevent me from taking naps, by the way.
You know, I kind of wish I'd never heard that. Yeah, not comfortable anymore.
Yeah.
It didn't prevent Cliff from taking naps. And, you know, oh, gosh, I was coming back from the very first shoot that I ever did for the old ARVN,
mm-hmm.
Being up at the field day, so W3AO, the last big field day.
Yeah, yeah.
And the guy that was helping me was driving, and I'm, you know, nodding off, and I look up, and traffic in front of us on the interstate was at a dead stop, and he is barreling at it, and he is zoned out. And I'm going, stop! And then he jams on the brakes and we fishtail around. And we stopped. We didn't crash. But man,
wow, that would be scary.
Yeah. That was, whoa.
Yeah.
So you're wide awake, right?
Yeah.
I mean, not now. Yes, now, but
driving.
Driving.
No, I can drive extraordinary distances, yeah.
Yeah,
with
you can.
No problem. You know, the key is, I probably shouldn't reveal these secrets. I have a table I use for minimum rest. And I've used that at work. You know, when the boss has asked me to do things I can't do, I tell him it exceeds my minimum rest, can't do it. And he just freaks out over that. But he loves the fact that, you know, I can cover many states in few days. And it's the same way when we go, you know, I got to get to minimum rest in order to make those drives sometimes.
Except that you have often said that the night before going to a ham fest, you can't sleep at all.
Yeah.
So yeah. Where did that rest come from?
It's much more of a problem.
You get so excited, you're like a little kid. You just, oh, it's a ham fest.
Yeah.
I used to feel that way about ham fest when I was, not a little kid, but, you know, teenager, early 20s and stuff. And
yeah.
Night before ham fest, I would be all excited until I realized that hamfests are pretty much all the same. There's some bigger, some smaller. Boring hams talking about boring ham stuff. Maybe that's why I don't do so much ham stuff on the show.
And then
boring.
The magic left for you?
The magic of radio has never left. I still really like the idea. But, you know, the hamfest, you walk around the flea market. I walk around the flea market looking at a lot of stuff I don't know what it is.
Yeah.
And you know, it's old junk, not necessarily predating my electronics experience, but stuff I have no idea what it is. I mean, there's stuff, easy stuff from the 60s and 70s, pullouts from, you know, computers and stuff that I don't know what it is. Old test equipment. And hams are poor conversationalists, except for you and me. And so the ham fest have ceased being really exciting anymore. And that's why I go to do shows, because that puts the interest in me. Just to go to a ham fest and walk around and be a ham, you know, not Not so much.
But a lot of your shows are about current events in ham radio, though.
Yeah.
And a lot of Ham Fest is about history. You see, two. You say that hams are not conversationalists.
Well, but, yeah, hanger geez, talk.
You know, I see them. There'd be two or three guys holding a box talking about it, and it'll be some project that was featured in a 1960 QST that some guy did a, you know, it's either the prototype from the actual article or one that somebody built from the article, and they'll be talking about that. And
if they could talk about how that's what it is, I'd be interested. But no, they're looking at the wavelength of the green light. You know, in endless fascination. So
yeah,
if I were an engineer, you know, maybe if I had a better, and maybe I'm just ashamed of my lack of an engineering background. That, you know, I am truly an appliance operator. I'm a very good appliance operator. Been operating appliances all my career. It's been a good career, but that's all I am. So maybe I feel ashamed about that. This is a Ham Radio Now. Confessions of hams. What do you got to confess, Jim?
Oh, let's see.
Okay, we're out of time.
If they knew how much I was on the air, they'd take my license because none.
Yeah, that's the case for an awful lot of people. I used to pride myself on how much I did get on the air. A lot of it was VHF and repeaters and stuff, but I pride myself on how much I would get on the air. It really is not so much anymore since I started doing the show.
Yeah, and I get on almost once a week when I'm going to meet some people for dinner on Friday night. And that's
on 1 2-meter simplex channel.
If I'm in town. Yeah, on a 2-meter simplex channel.
Yeah. And you bought radios recently. You bought D-Star radios and stuff.
I love radios, yeah.
You love having them.
Yeah.
But using them?
Yeah, I like fooling with them, programming them, different programming schemes and the software that programs them and all that. But using them, I just never have much to say.
Yeah. And
I listen on them some.
Yeah, and that we're going far afield. This could be another program. But I think that's why there are contests and DX.
Yeah, that could be.
Because it gives hams something to focus on that gets them on the air, gets them doing something without having to talk. Yeah, having to actually talk and think of something to say.
Yeah.
Because that's... Yeah. Like I say, that's hard.
Most of us don't have your problem.
Yep. All right. So, did you see enough Siskel and Ebert to know about the thumbs up, thumbs down thing?
Thumbs up. They liked the video. Thumbs up, one or two.
Movie.
Or
yeah.
Doesn't matter.
Well, I mean, they would each cast their thumb. You know. That became their trademark. In fact, it's so much of their trademark that if we do it, we'll probably be sued by who's ever got their intellectual property. But because they're both dead, but their company lives on.
Was it a digital thumb, like either up or down?
No, they literally went on camera and did a thumbs up or thumbs down. Although I think it eventually became a graphic.
But my question is, was it digital or was it analog?
Oh, I see. I don't remember any wavering. I think that the rules that they set for themselves was, I think it was up or down. It was up or
down.
So, so for me, the ARRL video is a thumbs down.
Oh dear.
Like you said, I really wanted that to be a wonderful program.
Yeah.
Wanted it to be great. I wanted to love it all the way through. And until the TX factor came along, I was going to say, I don't think we can within ham radio. I don't think we can produce something that big and complicated. I couldn't have produced it. I'm sure not for the money and time that they had to do it. If I had a year and a big budget, mm-hmm. I could have put the stuff together, and I have all the production capabilities to have made all that stuff the way I would have wanted it. Whether anybody would have said it's a better show or not, I don't know. Mm-hmm. A lot of people would not.
Yeah.
But for what they had, it's, you know, it is what it is, and it's probably about the best that could be done, which is just kind of a sad thing to say about the state of ham radio in media production. We just don't hold it in that higher regard.
Yeah, we're just not very good at it.
But well, we don't care.
For, for me, it's a thumbs up anyway. It's a thumbs up. Yeah. There were a few things I didn't like about it, but what I especially liked, you know, the walkthrough, the historical content, and the walkthrough history was great. Becky was a great presenter. Just a few minor things with the production and the ARRL and that.
Yeah.
But so I'll watch it again. If other people ask me for shows on Ham Radio, I would direct them to it.
Point them to that show.
Sure.
Okay. Yeah. The things that I would seriously have tried to have done differently, when I work with non-professional talent in their position of having to be on camera and say things, CEOs and
me.
You are a dream. You made a video of your own at your company, didn't you?
Yeah.
How'd you like that?
Oh, you know, I love myself. I wasn't very happy with it.
No, because you were awkward, stiff.
Yeah.
Not as awkward and stiff as you possibly could have been, because you've had some experience here.
Yeah.
But right now, you are not awkward, not stiff.
Yeah.
Why? What's the difference?
Oh, I'm giving my opinions.
Well, I mean, but you could tell me about stuff. You could talk to me about technical stuff.
Yeah.
And in this conversation, once again, you would not be awkward, not stiff.
Well, you know, in that video, I was very aware that I was making a video.
Yeah.
It was so purposeful what I was doing, and had one day to do it.
Yeah.
So,
and that's where all these people were. They were, you know, in the glare of the camera. Maybe that's why they had them pointing mock camera a little bit, or maybe they couldn't afford a teleprompter sitting in front of the lens. They had to have
a PC.
Their script somewhere off camera. It is so hard to do. And so I work with non-professional talent a lot. It's mostly in audio, you know, not so much worrying about pictures, but never been very successful in raising somebody more than a notch or two above where they started. They start very... I can't even act as stiff as most people can. I have beat that out of myself.
Now, you make a lot of commercials for political candidates, campaigning. And
you do those, yeah. That. Yeah. Oh, aren't those horrible when you see them on the air?
Yeah, they are. And the car dealers.
Yeah. Yeah, even the ones that get a lot of experience at it that often don't get much better at it.
I think the more experience, it actually just makes them even more over the top terrible.
Yeah. And they're pushing hard, but they're also, I mean, salespeople are a different category, as Cindy says, coin operated.
that's precious.
Yeah, but they're in a different category. Yeah. I mean, they have learned a style and technique that seems to be passed down from generation to generation to annoy the rest of us no end.
It works.
Yeah. So, But people whose job is not to be there, like all the folks that were in the ARRL, they do fantastic work in their real jobs.
Yeah.
And so the fact that they go on camera and pretty much suck at it is, it's just kind of sad to then have completed the project that way. I would have tried hard to find another way to make them not be so stiff and awkward in some other way of communicating that information. It also bothered me a little bit that there wasn't much of a reason to go from Becky talking about what was on her timeline to suddenly we're somebody else in a limbo set facing off camera, following up on what she said in many cases, but in some cases going totally far afield. Yeah. And just like, where did we go? We left the planet for a moment and went somewhere else. So those are the things that bothered me about watching the show.
Okay, and I didn't notice any of that.
Yeah, and those perhaps, and in this case clearly, are observations from someone who lives inside baseball. You know, just in the industry, sees all those things. You know, I can go to a movie and divorce myself entirely from production values, from the concept that I know how this is done, and just enjoy the movie. When I watch TV shows, it's mostly, don't tell the IRS this, because the big TV I've got down there, I wrote it off. And if the IRS ever comes to audit me on it, it's because I have to watch not only what I produce, but what everybody else produces, so I can see what's being done. The truth is that I just
you wanted a 60-inch TV
in a good show. I just get absorbed in the show. And why is my phone ringing? My phone is turned off. I muted my phone, and it unmuted itself.
What just a lot of malfunctions in here today.
Yeah, this malfunction junction.
What do you make of that?
Just we don't know what we're doing.
Okay. I'll go with that.
I know what it is. I've got a thing on my phone where if I turn the sound off, because I kept turning the volume down and not wanting it to be down, mm-hmm. there's this thing that makes me push another button that confirms that I wanted to turn the sound off. And I probably forgot to do that.
Oh.
When I turned the sound off.
Yeah, you know, before. If you'd use text message and people, you'd probably get a lot less phone ringing, because I called you when in a text message would have been much more appropriate this morning.
Yes,
oh, well. And I owe you 20 cents from the one I inadvertently sent the other day.
Yes, I boycott pure SMS text messaging because Verizon wants $20 a month for, at least in my plan, for unlimited text messaging. And
can you buy a package of messages for half that?
But they're not worth a penny. I mean, they cost, you know, how much of their infrastructure text messages take.
Oh yeah. It actually uses, right. Exactly yeah. right.
0.001.
Uses a control system that has to be there anyway.
Okay. And so less than zero.
Yeah.
So, and they charge an astronomical amount for it. And there are alternatives. Like AOL Instant Message and Yahoo Messenger, and there's the one that Facebook just bought for billions of dollars called WhatsApp.
Yeah, and all you need for those is an app, something that every phone automatically does anyway.
Using the data plan that you've already paid for. So, and I was going to put WhatsApp on my phone and maybe convince some people to do that. It seemed to do some neat things, and it doesn't work on my Nexus 7 tablet. Yeah. Not available.
So why is text messaging so popular? Maybe because it works. Everybody can use it if they don't mind the bill. And all you need to send somebody a text message is their phone number.
Yeah.
Unlike AOL Instant Messenger.
Everybody's got to be on the same thing.
Yeah.
So sheeple, quit... Well, we all need to find something we can agree on. I guess we agree on text messaging except for me.
Yeah.
All right.
Let's ask the readers what they think. How many readers use text message? How many
viewers? We have viewers. Listeners.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Not readers. So let's see what they say. Text messaging, yes or no? Do you use it?
Yeah, and if you use it, text Jeff.
I will reply to your text.
And if you don't, send me I'm on AOL Instant Messenger. They took away my KN4AQ. I used to be KN4AQ on AOL. It's the very first identity I had ever had on any online thing.
Took it away.
Yeah, because I never used it anymore, so it just disappeared.
Oh.
I could probably get it back, but it just disappeared. So I used to be KN4AQ on AOL, but I'm not anymore. But
okay.
You wouldn't have found me there. I wouldn't have been looking. So TX Factor.
Oh yeah. Okay, you first or me?
I just did it.
Oh, okay.
I'm afraid we're going to get sued for doing that.
Let's not do it then. Yeah. Okay, it's a big thumbs up.
There we go. Finger up. Point up.
I liked it. I liked the
upward pointing digit.
The three segments, you know, was very clear, distinctive segments. One of them was good for new hams. One of them was historical in nature. And one was an operating event. It was great. The three things that they chose to put on the opening show were great.
Yeah.
Great
so the content was good.
Yeah.
The production value is outstanding. The presentation, the people, the style.
Ham's doing ham stuff, and you know I love that.
Yeah. I had to go back and look at some of the programs that I've done before to make sure that I have done things kind of like that. Now, they had resources behind them, a bigger crew than I've had. They didn't have a big crew, but they had a few people behind them, and when you look at their credits. So there's some folks working behind the scenes. I've never had more than you, Cliff, helping me out. So, you know, they've got a little more behind them, and they've got some money right off the bat from Yaesu and from the dealer out there.
Yeah, I didn't like the commercials, but if that's what they have to have to bring us the show, it's a small price to pay for that show. That was a good show.
Yeah, the commercials?
Well,
I mean, they just could have been produced so much better. I don't know if they produced the commercials themselves or someone else produced them and they just put them in, but compared to the rest of the show, I mean, man, but just.
Well, you know, I don't care about the content of the commercials. It's the fact that there are commercials. You know, it's sad they have to have it. But like I said, if that's the price we pay to watch the show, then so be it. It's well worth it.
Yeah, but they could have been.
The commercials themselves could have been more.
They could have been as valuable to me as the rest of the program, or as entertaining, or as, you know, whatever.
You know, I don't want Bob and Nick and Mike spending a lot of the show's resources improving commercials. I want them to keep bringing us good content.
Yeah. Well, and they shouldn't have to, but
it's false to the advertiser, really.
Yeah. Now, I am in a very glass house here because I did essentially commercials for all the Tapper programs. And they were not produced commercials. They were just me talking about the products, looking at the company's websites and stuff like that. And they ran interminably long because I could not shut myself up.
Yep.
And I actually, for the first time, noticed that, and you guys that provided the major funding, the Tapper, Flex, and Elecraft, don't watch this part. When I watch the audience retention numbers, you know, it's up high at the beginning, and then during the commercial segment is down to 25%, and then after the commercial segment is over, it's back up 50% or so watching the rest of the shows.
So that just means they're sliding through the commercials.
Right. Yeah. They just zip on through.
Well, let me ask you this. Do. So their sponsor, let's say that their sponsor's budget for sponsorship was $5,000. Would it be better for them to spend $2,500 making and pizzazzy commercials and then give $2,500 to sponsor the show? Or should they spend, you know, $4,500 on the show and $500 making crappy commercials?
Here you are dragging me back to the ugly reality.
I'd rather have them spend almost nothing and make crappy commercials and give the rest of the sponsor money to Bob and the gang.
Okay. Well, I've noticed something about commercials. I was approached by a company asking me if I would produce commercials for them.
Yeah.
That I have since seen on other ham radio media, and they all suck.
You had the right of first refusal, I take it, on these commercials.
Well, I could have bid on them.
I
declined. I bid on one early and got turned down because I wanted way too much money.
Mm-hmm.
And I declined on the others because I was doing this show and I didn't want to get in the middle of producing commercials and doing the show and dividing loyalties that way.
Yeah.
The underwriting on the Tapper stuff is about as close as I ever want to get to something like that.
Okay.
If someone does want to advertise on this program and it becomes financially worth it, and I don't know that it ever would be, they'd have to produce something and hand it to me. Mm-hmm. Underwriting is one thing. Producing commercials is something else. But the thing I didn't like is, if you watch the ones that are I won't get into specific ones, but there are some where it's an announcer, voiceover announcer, who clearly doesn't know anything about amateur radio, but he does know how to read a commercial, except that he doesn't know how to read amateur radio words or has any idea what it is he's talking about. So he... Wrong emphasis, wrong feeling, wrong.
Yeah, I used to have to show a video once a week that was very similar. It had technical content read by somebody that had no idea what the content was. They apparently took all the takes they could afford and they produced what they had, and it was terrible. You couldn't hide the fact that it was terrible because people in the room watching it knew.
Yep. Tell you, I'm going to do a commercial for myself now.
Okay.
This is for those of you, there's almost nobody watching because we've been in this for 90 minutes or more.
Yeah.
Almost nobody watching. If you've got a company that produces your own in-house training, your own, you know, whatever the media that you do inside, and you're sick and tired of the guy they hire who's got no idea, especially if it's technical content, no idea how to read this stuff. And so it just sounds wrong. Hire me. It will sound right. Right?
Okay, sure. Sure. You know, I met Chad from, he did commercials for my circles. Was it Sprint? Was it Sprint? Some cell phone company. Chad was a blonde-haired guy and all. And he had he was an actor, but he had a very good grasp of the concepts he was talking about.
Because he was doing cell phones and he was a kid. So
could be.
I went in his own dog food.
It was actually a birthday celebration. My circle was celebrating their fifth birthday, and Coach Barry Switzer, from who had coached the Cowboys to a Super Bowl, was there.
What were you doing there?
The students were. I was at that company, and I can't remember what phone company, cell phone company that was for even, but I was teaching classes there, and the students all wanted to go down to their main office where this celebration was going on and eat birthday cake, and they all wanted to meet Coach Switzer. So when we got there, the line to shake hands and talk to the coach was like 100 people long, and nobody was talking to Chad, and that's who I wanted to see.
So you talked to Chad.
Oh yeah, I got a nice publicity photo autographed and all.
A selfie? Do a selfie with him?
No, it was just him, his publicity photo.
You know what a selfie is, right?
Oh, yeah. No, I didn't. I have no picture of me even being there.
Oh, okay.
But I did talk to the coach after the line went away. He had a Super Bowl ring on. Mm-hmm. They're big.
Somebody was saying on a show I was watching recently, I don't remember, it might have been Big Bang Theory. Why is the most iconic artifact of the most manly thing that humans are engaged in today, a piece of jewelry?
It's a big hunk of gold.
Okay.
Call it jewelry if you want.
Yeah. It's symbolism is more than the fact that it's a ring.
It's actually more like a brass knuckle.
Okay. Feels better, I guess. Yeah. All right. Shall we wrap
is
this
that
up?
More manly?
Yeah, there you go. Shall we wrap this puppy up?
Yeah, yeah. Thanks.
You started
Thanks,
it.
Thanks, Bob, Nick, and Mike. Bring us more. I loved it. I love what you're doing.
Whoops, sorry. Go ahead and tell them again.
Ah, Bob and Nick and Mike, bring us more. I love what you're doing. It's great to see Hams doing Ham stuff. Don't sell out and become a talking head program like this program has become. Bring us nice edited video shot in the field. We love it.
Because God knows I'm not going to do any more of it. Not unless Yesu wants to pay me to.
When you were doing it, it was great.
Yeah. I'll still do some. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I've got a plan for field day. You know, we're not going to do our go to station this year. What I want to do is get on the road. I'll have to see if I can scratch up the money to do it, because I'm at the bottom of the financial barrel for this. Mm. But I want to go back up to W3AO and see, this would be the 10th anniversary of the last big field day.
Oh.
And see what those guys are doing and look around at a few others up there. It'd be a short road trip, but all field-produced stuff. And
I might see what my brother's doing. You know, I've gone off and operated with them a few times over the years.
Same territory.
Yeah, same
Baltimore
territory.
Area.
Yeah.
So what I worry about for the TX factor is that I know how much work this program was. Mm-hmm. And so I'm looking forward to talking to Bob and maybe the other guys and about what they put into it and how often they think they can do this. Because one of the reasons why he's not on this show or hasn't been on right now is that he just wore himself out.
Yeah.
It was a lot of work.
Yeah.
And he's just been real busy, and they have real jobs. You know, they're not retired and they're not living off the fat of their wife.
Yeah.
So, and not that Cindy is fat, but Cindy makes the money in the family. So I worry how long they're going to be able to carry on. At the end of the program, they solicited video contributions from us. Not you and me, but us.
From Hams, yeah.
From Hams.
Yeah.
What danger, Will Robinson.
Yeah, they're going to spend a lot of hours looking at bad video.
Yeah, yeah. And Ham Nation gets some videos from Hams, and They try to squeeze them down short. And,
yeah,
and
but they don't mind showing bad videos, though.
No, and so and once in a while they get a few that are pretty good.
Yeah.
But most of them, you know, they are not TX Factor quality. So they will have to decide if they want to take in stuff that's not. Maybe we should make some stuff for them.
The kind of stuff you don't like to make?
Whoa, wait. What am I saying? If I'm going to make it, I'm going to put it here. Yeah, well.
Okay.
So you started the show out with the introduction, sort of.
Okay.
You want to finish it up?
Sure. Ham Radio Now, episode 133, A Night in the Theater. Thanks for watching, everybody. See you next time.
Now you got to say, he's Gary Pierce.
Oh, he's Gary Pierce. Pierce.
KN.
KN4AQ. Right. And I'm Jeff Wittick, AC4ZO.
Don't forget Arvin.
And that's Arvin, ARVN.
ARVIN
from Amateur Radio Video News, the show's predecessor and sister company, right?
Parent company, I would
Parent
say.
Parent company, okay, yeah. Okay.
Because in a moment, they're going to see that logo come in at the end. Foam. As soon as you finish saying...
Over.
Oh. And out. Bye, everybody.
Okay, goodbye.